Welcome back to Cambridge House Live. I'm Vanessa Collette here at the Vancouver Resource Investment Conference. And we're joined this morning by Frank Holmes, the CEO and CIO of US Global Investors. Welcome back, Frank. It's great to see you.
It's great to be back in Vancouver.
Now, Frank, let's talk a little bit about, I think, a blog post that you had on the weekend. And you're talking about US equities have not risen 7 years in a row at any other time in history except for one other time. And I think we have a chart up on the screen. Maybe you can tell us a bit about the significance behind that.
Well, the big point is that we have all these negative talking heads on television in particular that always, they have PhDs in bubbleology. So everything's a bubble. Anything goes up, it's got to fall. And so you have this tremendous run up in the stock market without asking, well, why has it done this? And the biggest risk for a big bubble is actually leverage. So has this stock market gone up for 7 years, but this would be 7 years because of massive leverage in, like housing did? No, it's not. It's a record number of companies that are actually paying down debt and increasing their dividends. So what is very, very different is that the dividend yield on a 10-year government bond. Now, why I share this for your listeners is a 10-year government bond prices everything in economics in America. All infrastructure, everything's off a 10-year. Well, not often have you been able to buy great companies like Procter & Gamble, Johnson & Johnson, and Coca-Cola that have dividend yields higher than a 10-year government bond.
Right, right.
Apple Computer, etc. So I think it's a different set of factors that investors have to be aware of.
What does this chart mean? I mean, the fact that markets have been rising for the last seven straight years, it's never happened before, and you're pointing out we're in uncharted territory.
We are, we're on an uncharted waters with low interest rates.
Right.
Where every negative news is a response that's positive, actually, because governments are very fearful. The only ones that have too much red tape is Europe. I mean, they talked about this idea of stimulating their economy 9 months ago. They still haven't got their act together.
Right, and what's the problem there? What do you think
because
is the main source?
Because it's socialist populist bureaucracy, whereas China responds overnight.
Right.
The PMIs come negative, okay, drop interest rates.
Yeah.
PMIs the next month, negative, let's stimulate housing.
Right.
It's a much different mechanism of making a decision.
Let's make it easier for people to buy homes, and that way they can stimulate the economy. So you're looking at, China and Europe, and you're waiting for Mario Draghi to make some tough calls, make some decisions?
Well, he keeps dragging his feet out only because the process of getting people to agree, they only agree when there's a crisis. It has to be of such massive consensus. Magnitude to respond. America's faster. You can see that America's ingenuity since 2008, what they've done with fracking. I mean, create the surplus because of their innovation.
Mm-hmm. Now, looking at the U.S. economy, we're looking at potentially having a rate hike. Do you think that's going to happen?
No, because I think there's too much fiscal drag. And fiscal drag is so often it's either taxes or it's regulations. And there's been so much regulations in the banking centers around the world. In fact, if you look at the super big banks, they become like tobacco companies.
Really?
All they do is get sued for billions of dollars all the time by governments. They can never get in the traction of making loans, and there's so many rules and regulations, and any rise in interest rates like they had last year immediately track housing fell out. So I think rates are going to stay low.
They're going to stay low, and if they were to raise rates, it would just throw off all the sort of recovery.
And politicians lose their jobs.
Right. Now, what do you think's been pushing oil down, this really steep decline that we've seen? What do you think is behind that?
I think there's two factors. One is Europe is a bigger trading post with China than America. People don't realize that. So Europe slows down with all these regulations and poor fiscal policies. This slowdown has a slowdown demand for energy. You have then the increase of energy supply from America. So America is no longer importing from Nigeria, from many other parts of the world. So they have been able to create their own supply, and that therefore you've had two things. Demand slacks,
right.
Supply increases,
right.
And there has to be a rebalancing.
Yeah, are we going to see a cut in supply? I mean, the U.S. doesn't look like they're going to cut their supply, but you've
got
OPEC.
What happens in the U.S. is because it's so dynamic, is that the supply of rigs drilling for oil, for gas has dropped dramatically.
Yep.
Oil hasn't. Oil is now starting to fall, and it will fall for the next 6 months dramatically.
Okay.
What that will do was create a supply coming from these new wells will drop, and I believe they'll drop substantially in a year from now.
Right.
So with that, then all of a sudden we'll see that rebalancing.
Right.
But this drop in oil stocks is unprecedented. If you look at numbers, it's 50-some-odd% in a short period of time, which is a buying opportunity because, historically, oil bottoms in February. So when you look at how strong the dollar's been up and how much oil's been down, we went back, and it's on our website at usfunds.com, 30 years of data points, and it is the third widest gap. And so the law of mean reversion is going to happen there more likely than the stock market crashing.
So you're getting into oil stocks right now, oil
juniors?
Looking
at those oil stocks that have the highest cash flow yields,
okay,
or the lowest cash flow multiples, right, based on this lower energy price.
Now, let's talk a little bit about gold. You've talked about gold as a currency. What's been the performance there in recent years?
Well, look at last year. The best performing gold stocks have always been recommending big cap as royalty companies because they have big margins, like a technology company.
Mm-hmm.
And outside of that, we're sleepers. Goldfields takes off. It's up 40%. Randgold takes off. It's in West Africa. And Harmony starts to take off. Why? Because in South Africa, the rand fell 40%. So if gold is basically flat for the year, but the currency which they pay all the local workers falls 40%, they now have a profit margin.
Right.
And it translates the stock prices going up. Now, I remember this in 2001, too. Gold went from 280 to 300, the best performing gold stocks. We were number one gold fund that because we had all our money in South African gold stocks. They went up 100% that year.
And what about gold's performance itself as a currency?
Well, this is a beautiful question because I published this this weekend, was showing gold in South African rand terms is a breakout. Gold in euro terms is gone parabolic. It's
wow.
A breakout. Gold in Japanese yen is a breakout. So it's so important that gold is money. In addition, you're seeing gold is that love trade. And so the slowdown in GDP per capita of China and India does impact that consumption. But India starts to turn. And now all of a sudden, from a year ago, we saw good demand out of India picking up.
And I think the World Bank just came out saying that India was going to be overtaking China now in terms of their growth.
Well, that'd be great. But I don't think they have such a command economy. There's too much paperwork. Now, their new leader, Modi, is an extremely capable person,
yeah,
of getting things done. But what China does so quickly is responds quickly. And when they want to build a new super 300 kilometer an hour light rail 20 feet above the ground, they build it.
Right. It happens.
It happens.
So what's your take on China right now? A lot of people are talking about slowing growth.
Yeah. Isn't that great? And China's stock market was falling, the A-shares, until this summer.
Right. It's been in August, really took off.
And you know what they were up? 52%.
It's huge. Almost, yeah.
52%. A spectacular run.
Yeah.
Because they changed the rules of convertibility. What China did last year is allowed the renminbi to be convertible into Singaporean dollars. And the conversion of A-shares, only Chinese people could buy, similar company listed in Hong Kong, that conversion take place. So one traded undervalued, it's been moving up. But their dividends were trading at 5% dividend yields, trading at 6x earnings. So all of a sudden, money starts flowing into that sector. And still, after this run, Chinese stocks that, for consumers, not resource stocks, consumption companies, railway companies, have been on a tear. Banks there have been on a tear.
Yeah.
So I think that China is going to continue to see that growth in the consumption stocks.
Right. Now, what do you think of Russia? I mean, obviously the fall in oil prices really affected the economy, but what do you see happening there?
Well, the only benefit is that the currency has fallen as much. I mean, it's the only real offset. We have an Eastern European fund. It was 50% long Russia. We liquidated everything last year,
okay,
in the spring, late spring. And with that, we believe there's no turn yet. If you look at credit default swaps of Ukraine and Russia, they're at all-time elevated levels.
Okay.
So the worry is, would they default like 98? I don't think so, because Russia has huge still reserves in gold and dollars. But I think they'll turn around and say they better have the peace agreement with the U.S. and Europe, and all of a sudden that currency would reset.
Now, what do you see as we wrap up here? What do you see specifically for gold in 2015?
Well, the DNA of volatility for gold, it is a non-event mm-hmm. for gold to go up $200 or fall $200.
Right.
You just must appreciate that over 30 years, this is it's a percentage change, and it's about 20%. So with that, gold it can go up another $100, and it's just normal volatility. Okay. Will it go up $400? I don't think so. But I think it's easy for it to go up $1,350. And this is vice versa, it's easy to go back to $1,200. It's going to vacillate back and forth until we get synchronized global growth like we had in 2006. We've not had that synchronized growth. When that happens, gold takes off.
So you're bullish on energy stocks and gold miners right now?
Yes, I'm bullish on those energy companies which have high cash flow yields. That's very, very important. No debt problems. And I'm bullish on royalty companies and some of the companies that show up in our portfolio that show rising gold production, like Klondex we like, companies of that nature. It's one of our top 10 holdings, and some of the South African gold stocks. And I think some of the Latin American countries like Colombia, its currency has fallen over 20%. I think their currency has to fall more, so that will benefit those gold producers or those gold mining companies in Colombia.
Great. Well, thank you so much for joining us again today, Frank. It was a pleasure.
It's great.